Okay, so let me say first, good afternoon, good night to everybody, or good morning, I don't know. So this is the first afternoon section of the Scuola Brazilian Dynamical Systems School. And this afternoon is dedicated to Lorenzo, like every other day, but this afternoon is special. So the first speaker will be Michal Rams from IMPAN. Micha, are you ready to begin? I think, Micha?
Yes.
Yes, okay, please share. You can share your about porcupines and other prickly animals, I suppose. You will talk, please.
But it tells me that I'm disabled from screen sharing.
Okay, maybe somebody should make you co-host. Yuri or Marisa, who is in charge of this?
Christina is making it.
Christina?
Could you try again, Michal?
Okay.
Yeah. Now you can try.
Yeah.
Do you see what I want you to see?
Yes, that's okay, I think.
Okay. So. I am to tell you a little bit about some part of what Lorenzo was doing for last years. I didn't want this to be the usual stuff that is here the theorem, we prove this, and here the theorem, we prove this, and here the theorem, we prove this. So I started to think, okay, what is maybe is there something special about this little bit of mathematics that would let me make the talk a bit differently? And it turns out that there is indeed something that we can say. Wait a second. Okay. So what is the type of dynamical systems it will be about? It will be a class of skew products of one-dimensional maps. That is, we have some one-dimensional manifold, which means an interval or a circle, and we have some finitely many maps on this manifold, and then we allow ourselves to apply those maps in any order we want, which mathematically we describe it as the cocycles. That is, we take the symbolic space denoting all infinite sequences of the finitely many symbols, the symbols numbering our maps, and then we have the action of the map on the one-dimensional manifold and the corresponding shift map on the corresponding symbolic sequence in the symbolic space. And the symbolic sequence simply describes the order in which we are going to apply the maps. All the possible orders are allowed, which means that the space, the symbolic space, is simply the full shift on k symbols, k being the number of maps. Okay, so this is a bit abstract, but the nice thing is that the full shift on the finitely many symbols can be replaced by Smale-Horchow, which is the two-dimensional diffeomorphism. So adding to this the maps Fi being diffeomorphism in the one-dimensional manifold, all this thing together is going to be a diffeomorphism in the three-dimensional space, which kind of explains why Lorenzo was interested in the stuff. Okay, so what is this special about this class of systems? Okay, this will be the part about old man rambling about the world not being how it used to be. It seems to be that we are doing more and more specialized things. In other words, the things that we are doing are interesting for fewer and fewer people. And it's more and more often that I see the paper and I'm not really interested what's inside. And it's more and more often that I see my paper and I honestly have a problem with explaining why it should be interesting for anybody else. And this is the same almost everywhere, but the one big exception of this rule, which I can say, is exactly this class of systems which Lorenzo and Katrin came up with, which is simply incredibly rich. It is so rich that there are plenty of phenomena, plenty of problems appearing here that are actually very interesting for people from far outside high dimensional smooth dynamics. And so my plan for today is to talk about those three-dimensional smooth diffeomorphism and not to say a single word about three-dimensional smooth diffeomorphism. The only thing I will tell you is why those things are interesting for people outside. Okay, that's the plan. So let's start. Let's start from the dynamical system that everybody knows and which for, I guess, many, many people is the first real dynamical system that they ever seen. That is from the logistic map, from the full parabola. The map on the interval x goes to 4x, 1 minus x. This map has plenty of interesting properties, and today I'm going to talk about just one special property of this map, that is this map has a gap in the Lapunov spectrum. What does it mean? Well, for any point, we can define the Lapunov exponent for this point as simply the exponential rate of growth of the derivative of the map starting at this point. I mean, for every point, this limit doesn't have to exist. If this exists, we call it the Lapunov exponent on the point x. And then such function is obviously invariant under the iteration of the map. So Berkov ergodic theorem tells us that this function, for any ergodic measure mu, this function is actually mu almost everywhere defined and mu almost everywhere constant. Okay, and what I claim about this map, I claim that when we look at the Lapunov exponents of ergodic measures, I can find some open interval of numbers such that there is no ergodic measure with the exponent being there, while I will have some ergodic measures with larger exponent and I will have some ergodic measures with smaller exponent. Okay, how do I know this? How can we calculate what are the Lapunov exponents of ergodic measures? Well, we can take, for example, fixed point. We have the fixed point at zero. At this point, the derivative is four. So the Lapunov exponent there will be logarithm of four. We have another fixed point at 3/4. And there the derivative is minus two. And so the Lapunov exponent for the Dirac mass there is log two. And it just doesn't make sense to continue because of course I can find the position of the periodic orbit of period two, because it's just the polynomial equation of degree four, so I can solve it. But if I wanted to find the position of the periodic orbit of period three, I would need to solve the equation of degree eight, and that's a bit more difficult. And of course, there are ergodic measures which are not periodic orbits. Okay, so we need some trick. How do we check what are the Lapunov exponents for such map? Well, it turns out that it has some magical properties. It is first, it has a special property that it is conjugated to the 10th map. The 10th map, x goes to whatever the formula, it simply says that it first starts at 0, 0, it has the slope 2, it goes to the point 1/2, 1, And from there, it starts to have slope minus two and it goes to the point 1, 0. And that is its map doing like this. Okay, but the logistic map has also a super special property, is that it is not only conjugated to the stent map, but the conjugation is actually smooth. It's a local diffeomorphism except at just 3 points. Okay, this meeting being a school and me being an evil person means that I won't give you the exact formula for the conjugating map. I will just give a hint. And it's really not difficult to get from this hint to the formula, and formula is not complicated. Okay, what does it mean that we are smoothly, that the two dynamical systems are smoothly conjugated? Well, it means that if we take, well, if F equals H, G, H inverse, then F squared equals H, G, G, H inverse, and the nth iteration of F is equal to H, nth iteration of G, H inverse. So if we have the trajectory which, well, does not start around those points 0, 1 half and 1, then the derivative of the nth iteration under this map of the map F is roughly speaking the same as the derivative of the nth iteration of this conjugated map G, give or take the derivative of the conjugation at the beginning and at the end of the trajectory. And this means that as if we have ergodic measure mu, which does not have atoms at point 0, 1 half or 1, then the generic trajectory of the measure mu starts far away from those points and ends far away from those points. And this means that the Lapunov exponent of the measure of this measure for the original map is the same as the Lapunov exponent for the map that you get after conjugation. But we took the conjugation to the 10th map, and the 10th map has the nice property that the derivative is everywhere equal to 2 or minus 2. So for the 10th map, absolutely every measure has Lapunov exponent log 2. And this means that for our original, for the logistic map, absolutely every measure has Lapunov exponent log 2 as well, except for those measures that have atoms of 0, 1 half, or 1. Do we have such measures? Well, there exists exactly one such measure, that is this direct mass at 0. And as we already checked, and for this measure, the Lapunov exponent is log 4. And no other Lapunov exponents are possible. So that's the story. And now two simple questions. First question, how it is even possible? Okay, what's the meaning of this question? Well, we have this map, this fixed point at 0, but we can take trajectory which starts somewhere very, very close to 0. And then it goes for the long time is still around 0. Then eventually it goes somewhere else and almost immediately comes back. So we have the trajectory that for most of its life, it sees the same derivative as the point 0 sees, that is, it has the derivative close to 4. So how came we cannot get the Lapunov exponent close to log 4 for such trajectory? We can make this trajectory even periodic. There are periodic trajectories like that. Well, let's do some simple calculation. Let's say that we want our trajectory to stay around 0 for 100 iterations. 0 is an expanding fixed point with the derivative 4. It means that we must have started from some place around 4 to power minus 100. This then for 100 iteration will be around 0, and then we'll go somewhere. Okay, but where we were one step before we came to the point 4 to the power minus 100. Right? The only place from which we could come here is here. We must have been around the position 1 minus 4 to the power minus 100. Just from here, one there, and then. Okay, but what was the previous step? How did we get here? Well, we must have been somewhere here. We must have been at the point 1/2 plus or minus 4 to the power minus 50. It is 4 to the power minus 50 because 1/2 is the critical point, it's quadratic critical point. Okay, and what was the derivative that we saw here? What is the derivative of this whole trajectory, which this whole trajectory of 102 iterations? Well, this part we know, the derivative here will be more or less 4 to the power 100. The derivative here is minus 4. The derivative at the point 1/2 plus or minus 4 to the power minus 50 is more or less 4 to the power minus 50. Because at the very critical point, the derivative is zero. And when we are so close, the derivative is also very small. So this bit of trajectory has altogether the derivative 4 to the power 50. Give or take some constant. It has 100 iterations, 102 iterations, and the derivative is 4 to the power 50, which means that we see the Lakunov exponent log 2. All the gain that we gain by staying a long time around the point zero was exactly cancelled by the fact that before going there, we must have passed close to the critical point. So that's the answer. Okay, and this gives you the answer to another question. This, in which place I'm cheating? The answer is that I'm cheating you because I'm looking at the potential, this potential logarithm of the derivative, which is not continuous. The space of invariant measure for the logistic map is the usual Poisson simplex. This is the space of invariant measure for the full tank map. There is nothing unusual there. If I took any continuous potential, then there would be no spectral gap. But the log f prime is not continuous potential. It's not continuous potential exactly because it has the critical point. This is the reason why it's not bounded. And this is the reason why one step in the iteration of the map can cancel the hard work of the long stretch of trajectory. For the bounded potential, this could not happen. Okay, so in a sense, this is nice example that shows you the spectral gap for the transitive map. Of course, if the map is not transitive, there's no problem of having any type of gaps. But it's not as good example as we would like.
What do you mean by spectral gap in this?
I mean here that at this place, I'm talking about Berkov spectral gap, that is, I'm taking some potential and I'm looking at the possible Berkov averages of this potential. Just like for the Lakunov exponents, Berkov ergodic theorem tells you that for any ergodic measure, you have well-defined Berkov average almost everywhere. And you can think about what are the possible values of Berkov averages for the given potential coming from different ergodic measures. And again, the spectral gap would mean that there exists some interval which is between some possible values of Berkov average and some other possible values of Berkov average, but that does not contain any Berkov averages.
I see.
And of course, this cannot happen for the Poisson simplex. It cannot happen when the space of invariant measure is the Poisson simplex. Because ergodic measures would be dense, and then in the Wigstad topology, the Berkov averages are, of course, a continuous function of the measure. Okay, so the example is here. That is, it is one of the maps in this Lorenzo's zoo, we have this map here at zero. It has two fixed points at zero and one, and everybody else it moves to the right. We have another map at one, which takes the point one and moves it to zero, and is in general mildly contracting. And this line P signal is not here. Okay, we have such a system, and you remember that we are allowed to apply those maps in any order we wish. So where do we see the point with very large Lyapunov exponent? Well, we see it at the point zero if we apply only the map F0. If we are at zero and we apply the map at zero, we stay there. So this is simply the fixed point. And the Lyapunov exponent will be equal to the logarithm of the derivative of this map at zero. And it is, well, on this picture, the largest derivative that we can have anywhere. The question why this whole map is transitive is a bit complicated, but Lorenzo and Katrin put some kind of condition that guaranteed that the map is indeed transitive. Okay, so now the question is, do we have spectral gap? Yes. Can we maybe, well, as this is simply the point of maximum of the derivative, the only way we could have the Lyapunov exponent close to derivative at this point would be that we have the trajectory that spends a lot of time around this point. So once again, we are coming to this kind of argument that we have trajectory which starts around zero, which stays a long time around zero, and then it goes somewhere, and then it tries to come back. Well, the problem for this map is that simply there is no way for such trajectory to fast come back, because the only way to come back to the neighborhood of zero is to first get to the neighborhood of one. And the only way to get to the neighborhood of one, which as you see is not even in the range of the map F1, so the only way to get there is to simply apply the map F0 again and again and again. And as you see, if you want to spend a long time, time n around zero, you need to start at some distance like log n, sorry, like exponential, some like e to power minus n, e to power minus some constant times n. But to get there, you need to get to also exponentially small distance from one. And to get to the exponentially small distance from one using just the map at zero, you need to apply this map the number of times comparable with n. So while the map is transitive, there simply isn't any trajectory that spends a big part of its life around zero. If we want to be spent a long time around zero, we first need to spend comparably long time around one. This means that we have indeed the situation that we have two separate subsets of the space of invariant measures. We have the Dirac mass at zero, and no other measure comes close in the Wasserstein distance. In the weak star topology, this measure, this ergodic measure, is far away from every other ergodic measures. All other ergodic measures are about the trajectories which spend some time in the center of the interval, going right with the map of zero, then going left with the map of one, and doing some circles there. Okay. We have the positive distance in the weak star topology, positive distance in the Wasserstein metric. And this actually means that we have the spectral gap in, well, almost any potential except if we are exceptionally unlucky and we choose the potential such that its value at the point zero lies somewhere in the middle of values at the other point. Okay, so that's first thing. But you can say, okay, this example is not good enough because we have just one measure which is far away. Can we do better? Can we have the really two subsets of measures and both subsets to be big, positive entropy? Two subsets of ergodic measures far away from each other. Well, we can. We just need to add this third map. Yeah? And this is this line that was not here, now it is here. Yet another map, which again preserves the fixed point at zero, expanding fixed point. And if we add this map carefully enough, then we still have the spectral gap. But just adding this map slightly increases the range of possible Lapunov exponents we see here. Maybe it slightly increases the range of Lapunov exponents that those trajectories will provide. But if we are careful, then they are still not close enough. At the same time, now, staying at zero, we can apply the map of zero, or we can apply the map of two. But if you remember, what you see on this picture is only the stable direction. The whole system is three-dimensional. In the stable direction, those trajectories stay at zero, but they are still doing something interesting in this stable unstable plane, hence positive entropy. Okay. And can we do something even better? Can we do not two, but three subsets or 27 subsets or any number of subsets? Yes, we can. And the picture actually doesn't even change much, at least this picture. What changes a bit is the thing that I do not show you, that is the stable unstable plane. But is there? We cannot work with the full shift, but we are working with certain subshift of finite type. But on the stable manifold, the picture is exactly the same as you see here. Much time. Oops. I think I'm going much slower than I wanted, so I must start talking faster. I'm sorry for what happens. Okay, so that was the first thing that I wanted to say, but the second thing was actually larger and somehow almost out of time already. So the second part that I wanted to talk about was about matrices. I mean, everybody learned the matrices on the first year in the university, so by the time you are finishing university, you are perfectly certain that matrices are very simple, that you understand them. And in particular, that you understand what does it mean to multiply matrices. I know because I was certain of this too, before I started actually trying to multiply some matrices myself. So what will happen when we multiply matrices? The simplest possible situation, we take some K matrices, and we multiply them in any order we like. Then again, mathematical description of this is matrix cocycle, which is constructed more or less the same way as before, but just with multiplying matrices. Okay, and in order to, first, you know, it would be not a problem to find something complicated if we are taking 10 by 10 matrices. So let's take the simplest possible matrices, SL2R. 2 by 2 matrices with fixed determinant. There's nothing simpler than that. It is, you know, distilled essence of matrices. And if they behave ugly, then it will not be because they are complicated, it will be because they are matrices. Okay, what are we going to calculate? We are going to calculate something which again is called Lapunov exponent. I'm sorry, but some people are just not very inventive with names. And this is simply exponential rate of growth of the norm of the product of matrices. And again, we have ergodic theorem. This time it's called oscillatory multiplicative ergodic theorem, which tells us that for ergodic measure, this thing actually exists and takes the constant value mu almost everywhere. And it's called oscillatory multiplicative ergodic theorem because it was done by the Chinese mathematician called Yao 10 years before oscillators. Okay, and now you would think that this must be simple, so I will show you two examples. The first example. Let's take two matrices. The first of those matrices is just 2 1/2 diagonal matrix. The second of those matrices is simply rotation by 90 degrees. What are they doing? Well, as long as we apply the map, the matrix A1, we are going to stretch everything in the horizontal direction and shrink everything in the vertical direction because we have the determinant one. So no stretching without shrinking. And then we see the matrix A2, and this changed the horizontal to vertical and back. And then from this moment on, the matrices A1 will shrink everything that they before were stretching and stretch everything that they before were shrinking until we see the matrix A2 again, which will come back to the original situation. In other words, if we take the any Bernoulli measure which takes the matrix A1 and A2 with positive probability, then it will give us the Lapunov exponent zero. That is what, even if those matrix A2 appear only with very, very small frequency, they are still making the whole situation into basically a random walk. And the random walk, unbiased random walk, is not fast enough to give us the positive Lapunov exponent. But of course, if we pass with epsilon to zero and those Bernoulli measures converge to the Dirac mass telling us that we are to apply the matrix A1 always, then the Lapunov exponent immediately jumps to logarithm 2. That is, the Lapunov exponent is not a continuous function of the measure. Okay. Example two. This example, I won't give you the exact formulation, but you need just to believe me that in the parameters, there is an open region in which that behavior is actually generic. So again, cocycle of two matrices. And this time we are asking, okay, what sequence, in which order we want to multiply those matrices to have the maximal possible growth of the norm, the maximal possible Lapunov exponent. And the answer is that we need to, well, if we took just two numbers and in which order we have to multiply those two numbers and to have the maximal possible growth of the product, well, this would be trivial. Yes? We just take the largest of the two numbers and we just multiply this number by itself all the time. With matrices, it's not like this. In this situation, it turns out that the maximal growth of the norm is achieved when you multiply those matrices in order given by a Sturman sequence with the frequency given by those matrices. I mean, this is maybe not the precise statement because, well, of course, if you change the sequence of matrices, if you replace just finitely many matrices, this doesn't change anything in the limit. Yeah? So there is not one sequence of matrices which maximizes the growth. There is the formal way of stating that the Sturman sequences are the best ones, but I'm not going to, I have no time. Okay, so what is this first example telling us? Well, the first example is telling us that this thing, which you could think of as like taking the Birkhoff averages with the potential given by the logarithm of the norm, is not so because when the product of the two norms is not multiplicative. that is the norm of the product of two matrices, is not equal to the product of the to the product of the norm. It can be strictly smaller, and what we see in this example is direct effect of this product being smaller. What this tells is that the product of that this potential, the norm of the product of matrices, also depends on the order in which we multiply those matrices. That is, this potential is not commutative. And those are two main things which the matrices bring to the fold and which makes everything, well, very strange. And of course, how much time, okay, by how much time I'm allowed to prolong my talk?
Not too much, in fact, because I you have 1 minute. You can go more 1 minute.
1 minute, you are terrible.
It is 60 seconds.
You are evil. You are absolutely evil. Okay, so the bicycle cycles can be good or can be bad. And we are doing a classification. And classification tells us that there exists actually the open set in the space of cocycles, which is nice. Those are cocycles which are dominated, and they are, they are, for them, the product of the matrices is not multiplicative with respect to norm, but is quasi-multiplicative. It's up to a constant, it's almost multiplicative. And this is the nice area where everybody is able to prove many things. In other words, the boring area. And there is the interesting area, which is also open, in which no hope for having anything like this. That is where the really complicated things happen. Okay. Now, there is actually the better way of writing this classification. It came from the paper by Avila Bocchio-Cost. They state it a bit differently, but we can say it like this. The cocycle, the matrix is working on the two-dimensional plane, but it is working in the linear way. So you can think of this as acting on the projected line. That is, you simply take the multiplication of the matrix time a vector and divide it by the norm of the multiplication of the matrix by the vector. And this is the map from the projected line to projected line. And then the nominated cocycles, they correspond to the hyperbolic action. And the elliptic cocycles, they correspond to the robust non-uniform hyperbolic action of the resulting cocycle. The resulting cocycle of what? Well, projected line is a circle. And the action of the matrix on the projected line is the diffeomorphism of the circle. As you see, we landed squarely in the middle of Lorenzo's zoom. Okay, and the other things that would be very interesting, but you don't let me to tell you, was how Lorenzo and Katrin and me were trying to describe the work of the robust non-uniform hyperbolic cocycles of that type. And it was actually very surprising, but we were able to get several results which were not known for people looking at the matrix cocycles, even though there are really many people working on the matrix cocycles, and there are in fact several books written on this topic. But well, what can I do? Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you. That's nice. Michal. Okay, thank you, Michal. This is a revenge of people giving you just 35 minutes, but that's life. So are there any very quick comments or questions? Okay. No?
Can you put back the slides, please?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry?
Michal, can you put the slides again? Okay. Yuri maybe can.
Formula. Can you give us a hint of what is this this last slide? I mean, I'm giving you one more minute to in the questions.
About this one?
Yes.
Okay, so what we did, the main results were one thing about the how large, something which is also called Lapunov spectrum. As I mentioned, some people are really not inventive with the names, but this time this word means the function which for every possible value of Lapunov exponent gives you how large set of trajectories gives you this Lapunov exponent in the terms of entropy. So that's the natural in this situation way of describing the size of the sets.
Mm-hmm.
So there is the whole interval of possible values of the Lapunov exponent, and there is a function which, okay, I did not give you the picture here, but it looks basically like McDonald's symbol, that kind of M, with this local minimum at the in the center at the zero exponent, and some maximum to the right, some maximum to the left. And we can describe this using, using not exactly pressure function, but several pressure functions. There is some such idea which is called hidden pressure, and this came from complex dynamics in the paper of Makarov and Smirnov. Again, I'm totally not going to be able to explain it in 1 minute. And the second kind of result, which this is called persistent variational principle, it says that we can also say that for every possible value of the Lapunov exponent, we can actually construct an ergodic measure with this exponent and with entropy arbitrarily close to this maximal possible value of the Lapunov exponent for the entropy for this exponent. This was something which was maybe not too difficult for the exponents different from zero. For quite some times, it was difficult to do for exponent zero, but we managed to do it last year. So now the picture is complete.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. So let's thank again, Michal, for a fantastic talk.